Hello, it's the Anfield Wrap. No, it's not Neil Atkinson. It's Rob Gutman. I'm standing in his place. He's still the other side of the universe. So it's just me you've got. So what could possibly go wrong? To find out, I've got Peter Hooton, Dan Vincent and Stu Wright. Boys, it's going to go off here. No, Neil, we can do what we like. Lunatics, asylums.
I just want to clarify one thing. How come we don't ever get invited to these glamorous trips abroad? Or, sorry, how come you don't?
I've asked myself the same question, Peter, in the small hours. Actually, no, there is a reason for this. Well, there is one reason. I have turned them down in the past because I don't like flying very much.
Right,
yeah. I am B.A. Baracus, or whatever he was called, out of the A-team. I've got to be knocked out and put in a crate to get on the plane.
Yeah. Right.
I really don't like flying long distances.
Yeah, I'm the same. Yeah.
I have to get very, very drunk, and I can only do that for about three-hour haul flights before it gets a bit dangerous for all concerned. Anyway, moving on. Opening question, as is the tradition around these parts, and this one comes off the Twitter from @HenryJackson87. And it's a good question, this. I'll start with you, Pete. It's in the context, the tenuous context of Liverpool being around, in and around LA. What's the greatest film you've ever seen that's set there in LA?
The greatest film I've ever seen?
LA. What's your fave LA film?
Oh, God. I mean, made in LA or set
in LA? No,
yeah.
Quintessentially an LA film.
Yeah.
There's a load of them, you know, I researched.
Oh, There's so many, isn't there? I don't know. Manhunter, was that in LA?
Why not? Yeah. It feels like it.
Yeah, Manhunter.
Like yeah, okay, well, God, that's a great film, that. Stu?
Blade Runner.
Lovely choice.
I think so. I like Blade Runner.
You researched this, haven't you?
A little bit. Yeah. But it's the whole, you know, dystopian future backdrop that I like in the same way that I like a Rob Gutman restaurant. You know, it's very much,
what a
the
guy,
film
yeah.
is very much like A Night at Miss Kitty's.
Yes, so. Isn't it just? Who knew? It's a great film, Max. It's LA in 2019.
Yeah.
I was almost going to pick that one myself, actually, but I've got a better one. Don't worry. No,
well,
it's
there
not.
You go, yeah.
Go on, Dan.
Well, I had a little research on it just because I was thinking, I know that I love loads of films, but I don't really know where they were all set.
Yeah.
And Terminator 2 came up.
Really?
Yeah, so I'm banging into Terminator 2. It was one of the films that I watched when I was, like, younger, not really allowed to watch it, and still watched it in my nans. It was Boss, so, yeah, I'm going for that.
Okay.
Terminator 2, that's Judgment Day.
It's a solid choice. Yeah, when I looked at it, they had top 50 films in L.A. There's a lot. Virtually every other film you've seen is set in L.A. Pulp Fiction's in L.A. I don't know, Citizen Kane's probably in L.A. But, no, I'm picking Mulholland Drive. It's a great film.
Nice.
But there you go. So let's talk about football. Let's talk about Liverpool. Stu, I'll start with you. We're going to sort of broadly recap the week Liverpool have had in the United States, and in the latter part of the show, talk about a really exciting Anfield Wrap development, an interview the boys got over there with Jurgen Klopp, and we'll come on to that a bit later on. But starting off in sequentially, the Chelsea game was a bit of a tight shit game, wasn't it?
Yeah, I agreed with what Klopp said after the game, that we did dominate the game. We had most of the possession. We seemed to be the drivers in the game, but we did struggle to create chances. I mean, I think we barely got a shot on goal, if any, and that concerned me. But you know, you've got to take it for what it is, haven't you? You know, it's a pre-season game. I know there's been a bit of talk about another set piece, us conceding from another set piece. But it was notable that it was Grujic who was marking Cahill. Wasn't he?
Yes.
And I think, you know, that's just, you know, a bit of a welcome to Premier League football, even though it wasn't a Premier League match. You know, we were playing a Premier League team, and he might just have a little bit of adapting to do there. I wouldn't necessarily, you know, come the first game of the season, want Grujic marking the opposition's best header of a ball from a set piece. I think, you know, even though he's a big lad, I think, you know, you just put them, it's likely that teams will target him, I think, as he adapts.
Can I just slightly contradict you on something? Because I saw an analysis of the game afterwards. I saw the same thing as you did. Oh, shit, Grujic, he's a big unit, he's a grocky, 6'3", and he's been done in the air. And paid a huge amount of attention to how he'd been done in the air. I saw Neil Mellor analysing it on LFC TV a couple of days later, and he made the point, I think it was Neil Mellor, isn't it, that Liverpool was zonally marking. And it's not just Grujic, it's Kael, who scores, gets the run on Grujic and Firmino, and it's an issue of zonal marking. And are we? Nobody noticed last season whether Rafa, there you go, Freudian slip, whether Klopp was a zonal or a man to man.
We did use zonal a lot last year. I felt since Klopp came in, and where we struggled was attacking the ball. I felt that in those early days under Rafa, when we went to zonal, and the players were too stationary as the ball came across. And we'd struggle, we'd suffer because of that. After some time, you know, we did become more aggressive at attacking the ball and leaving our set positions and making a run at the ball to clear. And in the occasions last year where I felt that we struggled in set pieces under Klopp, I felt again that we were too stationary. And I was hoping that it was something that we would eradicate in pre-season. It was something that just needed more hours on the training ground. But to be honest, I didn't look for that on. In Cahill's goal, I wasn't particularly paying that much attention. It was on very early hours of the morning.
Did you see any you recall, Pete?
I must admit, I mean, I can't really analyse this game because I had zero interest in it whatsoever. And it's a terrible admission, really. But I think, you know, playing Chelsea early hours of the morning, I just wasn't that interested.
I just wasn't that interested.
And, you know, pre-season's never really that interested me, you know. I mean, it's hard to come on and analyse pre-season games when you're not interested at all. But I watched bits of the game over the weekend, you know, but the Chelsea game, in fact, it caught me by surprise. Just after the Euros, I just thought, we were being pre-season training for a lot longer, you know, but obviously... that wasn't the case. Not all the squad were back for the Chelsea game, were they?
No, we were. You know. We were still missing the majority of the England lot, I think. Yeah. Did you see it, Dan? I mean, I wasn't able to watch it at the time because I'm not insane and I can't be up at that time of the night watching football. And I do like pre-season, and it's spoiled the pre-season for me. This the times they've been, because you know, it's an excuse to go down the pub and watch some football pre-season, or to go to the match. I went to Tranmere earlier in the thing.
Yeah, I did myself. I was excited at the beginning, like I thought, I couldn't wait for the Tranmere game. Like I was there early and everything. I couldn't wait because it was just a taste of normal football back. I'm not as heavy as Peter on it, but I'm a little bit like it. It is our pre-season, especially when it's mad hours and that, but I've seen the majority of the game, but only on highlight clips, if you like a long match of the day version. But the one thing that stuck out like a sore thumb, unfortunately, was the goal. I mean, I understand it's all different and new players, and maybe it was a different way of defending the corner, but it is annoying. It is annoying that, like, you can see the goal from a set piece against Chelsea, who you're going to be facing next season. You are just left thinking, don't be doing that again this year. Like, I understand they'd be hard to break down as well on the flip side of it, because that I think showed what Chelsea are going to be like this season under Conte. They're going to be pretty solid, hard to break down maybe. But the goal did annoy me, just the fact you conceded from a set piece again. I think every time we concede from a set piece, it's going to annoy people. Because you're always going to go, oh, that again. But... you know,
I've just watched it again there now.
Can you talk us through the goal? Because I'd like to know what happened.
Yeah, you can have a look if you want, but I'll show you now. But like I said before, they were completely stationary. And the key to turn that down.
The
key to zonal marker is, you know, is from that starting position that you have, is being able to take three or four steps forward and attack the ball. To counteract the players who've got to run against you. And when you look at us there, no one made those few steps. No one took those few steps as the ball came across, not just Grujic. Everyone was still in their starting position by the time Kael headed the ball. And that's a worry.
I've just watched it. We've conceded that goal so many times.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's unbelievable, isn't it? You
know? And then we put Aston. That was heartbreaking, as you said about it, Stu. We've signed a few bigger lads, haven't we? And for the biggest of them, who's looked really good, Grujic, to be done like that. But focusing on the positive, because the truth of the matter is, Dan, Liverpool did dominate that game without creating anything, and Chelsea didn't create anything aside from that set piece. For Liverpool, I did get to watch all of it, and it was a struggle. I'll never get that hour and a half back. But The young lad, who's another tall lad, Ajaria, has come from the under-18s. I've mentioned him on the show. Gibbo hosts about the Central League show, which we cover all the under-18s and under-21s. Ajaria has been an important player in those sides, but he's been a quiet revelation, I feel, in the pre-season games, and he was our man of the match in that one. He's a prospect, isn't he?
Yeah, 100%. I didn't know a lot about him, to be honest, until the Samia game. And then all game I was thinking, who's that kid? And he was superb, and he's just gone from strength to strength, to be honest. And against the likes of a Tranmere, you can look and think, well, you know, okay, it's just Tranmere and whatnot, but he's just carried it along with him. And he was our best player by a mile. We were the best team, but like you said, it's just a little bit, although it's a friendly, you don't want to go on too much about it, but the fact that we were the dominant team, the fact that we didn't really create much with that, and then you go and conceive Mr. Peace, you did come away from it a little bit like, oh God, this is going to be the same story again, you know. But he was superb in the middle. It's a shame about the knock he's took now.
Well, the other setback from that game, Peter, not bigger than the goal by a mile, was the blow the keeper took. Yeah. Carrius. I've liked the little bits we've seen of him so far. His best quality.
It looked so innocuous, that, didn't it? You know?
I know it did.
You know,
I know it did. His best quality being that he's not Mignolet, which is always an asset in a keeper for me. And but you know, when the news broke, whatever night it was, the middle of last week,
collective sigh, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, I could hear.
Yeah,
I was
gutted.
I was out for my tea on holiday, and my lad went, Carrius is out for 8 to 10 weeks. I went, oh fuck off, is he?
Yeah.
And he went, yeah, he is. I said, everyone's gutted, aren't they?
Didn't believe it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just one of those blows that you know you come to expect really with Liverpool recently. You know, I mean, it's big disappointment. But you know, let's face it, Mignolet, you know, he's not the greatest keeper in the world. He's not an awful keeper, I don't think. I think you know he's.
I'll bring Dan in for prosecution in a minute on this, Pete. So you go big on this.
I don't think he's a terrible keeper. I think what he's suffered from in the past. Is his centre-halves not being confident enough in front of him, you know. He's nowhere near as good a keeper as Pepe Reina, for example. So with Carrius, you know, we were expecting, oh, great, we've got a new keeper, and Mignolet is going to have to fight for his place now. It looks like it's the opposite way around now, you know, which is a big blow.
Yeah, Dan, it's heartbreaking. It is heartbreaking for me, because I just thought we'd seen the back of Mignolet. Because I know he'd been brought in as
sorry, Simon.
Well, that's it. Because everyone's like, you know what? I know that we brought Carrius in for competition as such, but I think everybody knew that he was going to be number one. And I was thinking, well, that's Mignolet done. I thought we'll have him on the bench for the season, the odd cup game. Then he won't want to be the number two. He'll be gone. So I was like, I was buzzing with it. But now it's like he's back in now. Mm.
Just to and say the worst that, thing is,
he's back in now.
The worst thing is broken hand, isn't it?
That's what I mean.
Yeah, it's not even a thigh strain or something, which you think he's going to recover.
Toe, you know.
Because the thing with Mignolet with the centre-halves as well, like just going back to that, I feel like he made the centre-halves nervous.
Yeah.
Rather than the other way around. Yeah. I just feel like he... And now we've got a new centre-half pair and we've got a couple of new centre-halves who look good. And I'm thinking he'll ruin them in.
I was watching Clavan knocking the ball back to him casually.
Honestly,
do you know what you're doing here?
Yeah, he will.
The thing is, though, I mean, if we go back not so long ago... If our first choice keeper wasn't available through injury or just because he'd been benched, the next in line was Brad Jones, and he was throwing him in against Man United. Mm. You know, so
is he well better though?
I think he's a lot better than Brad Jones. I think you know, if you were to tell me that Mignolet stayed at the club as Liverpool's number two and was hardly ever called upon, but he was the number two, I'd be all right with that. I don't think he's not a keeper who should be Liverpool's number one. If he's at a top club, I think he's a number two. But he is a Premier League quality goalkeeper, as much as it pains me to say it. It's not someone I want to be seeing coming out in the, you know, with our lads every week. But I think it could, you know, if you look at it that way, we've upgraded in terms of our number two, even in this circumstance. Because if we say it was Mignolet who got injured the other day, if we didn't have Carrius, and it was Mignolet who broke his hand. Then we've got Brad Smith in goal against Arsenal first game of the season and for the 10 games after that. So how are you all feeling about that?
probably the same as I'm feeling
really?
Now.
Really?
Yeah.
Honestly, yeah, I am, you know, because I just, I think he's woeful.
Do you remember Man United?
But it's going to be the first 3 months of the season, arguably, that he's going to be out.
Yeah,
now.
No, no. Listen.
And if we had a goalkeeper who was fit all the time and I kept looking at the bench and it was Mignolet, like, I don't think Mignolet would get a game for any decent team.
But I'm with you. Let me make this clear.
Doesn't sound like it's
you. No, let me make it clear. I was absolutely devastated. I was so angry the other night when I heard he was injured.
However, I'm just putting it out there
that, you know, from my point of view anyway, Mignolet's an upgrade on Brad Jones as number two.
I think my view of it is like this: is Mignolet cost us points last season. Although there'll be the odd game, somebody will find, oh, that save he made in the last minute. I'm sure that happened too. But generally, we all not kid ourselves, he didn't cost us points. And I think his teammates knew that. And I think psychologically, having a new keeper behind would have given that defence a lift.
Yeah, yeah,
and
definitely.
I think to have that taken away, when you're trying to start this bold new era, and you have that, I think the keeper was almost the cornerstone of that bold new era. Mm. I think that's the psychological blow here. It's not so much about Mignolet, it's about the past. Well, it is, of course, but it's about the past that he represents as much as anything.
The big worry as well, I think, is whoever starts the season with the number one shirt, with the shirt as a goalkeeper, they've got such an advantage because it's really difficult to drop a goalie unless they've had an absolute mare, which doesn't happen every week. You know, so just because Karius is out for 10 weeks, it doesn't mean to say that we can assume automatically on the 11th week that he's going to be in goal and Mignolet is going to be dropped. We can't assume that. Mignolet could well be difficult to remove and we might be turning our hair out for a while longer.
Till Christmas.
Yeah, we could be. We could be.
I can't even imagine it.
Yeah, I've really brought it down.
We're already making excuses for not getting in the top four.
The thing is, for me with Mignolet, though, is if he makes a mistake first game of the season at Arsenal, you know, the next few games, we're just going to be done.
I'm going on
everyone,
the pitch.
Yeah, because everyone is just going to be like, oh, here we go again, this is a joke, you know, him in goal. And
they will, though.
You can see everyone going mental now if he lets a free kick in like the Adam Johnson.
Let's hope he's not listening to this.
I hope he is.
I know, I was thinking about that, yeah. But this is football, Simon. You know, you are paid to take this pain.
Yeah,
sorry,
yeah.
Lads. Okay, we'll move this on before we character assassinate him any further. Actually, it's not a character assassination, it's just about your ability,
exactly,
Simon.
Exactly, yeah.
About where you do your job. Let's move swiftly on. The AC Milan game. Mm. Peter?
Yeah, well...
I quite enjoyed that.
Yeah, we looked very impressive, didn't we? I thought so. I mean, if you look at pre-season friendlies, you'd say generally teams are at 60-70%, aren't they? They don't want to get injured and that. But AC Milan genuinely looked at, like, you know, 30-40%. Yeah. I don't know whether it was the shirts, the new shirts would dazzle them or what. But, you know, AC Milan were just on the... They were on Venice Beach, weren't they?
Well, do you know what they did in their last game, surprisingly? Because I thought...
Yeah, they played well, didn't
they? They beat Bayern Munich on penalties after 3-3. So, I don't know, do you think we made them look shit or they just were that rubbish?
I think Liverpool tried harder than them. Trying to impress the manager.
Yeah.
That's what it'll be. And, you know, new signings coming in. And there's a lot of pace there. And you know, we looked really good going forward, you know. And I think there was real signs there that, you know, some of the signings, you know... look impressive, you know.
I thought so. Dan, first half, although, you know, I broadly agree with Pete that they were no great shakes. They were organised, as you expect Italian team to be. They got men behind the ball, and it was a challenge to break them down. And we worked hard without getting through them first half. But I was impressed in particular in that opening 45 with Mane.
Yeah, he's been impressive since he started, really. He just needs that goal, doesn't he? I know it's pre-season, but you want him to just get that goal, don't you? He's had a couple of chances, but he looks like he's going to be a massive outlet for us, to be honest. I've been more impressed than I thought I would be with Mane. I was happy we signed him, but the speed of him, you know, he just gives you that something different all the time, you know?
I think what we'll see this season with, like, pace with the likes of Mane and that, you'll see a different Lallana, I think, because... He'll have so much movement around him. You know, I know he's been criticised a lot by Liverpool fans, but I think he was possibly one of our best players in the second half of last season. And Lallana now, with pace around him, he's going to look a different player.
I rate Lallana, I rate him, I think he's a good
player. It was interesting tactically, Stu. I don't know if it was you noticed it or not, loaded question. The way we lined up, Lallana seemed a lot more central, a lot more midfieldy in that game. Everyone interprets these things differently, but it looked to me something of a, let's look at the first half, the way Klopp set up, something of a 4-1-4-1, should we call it, with behind the striker Sturridge, the central two looked to be Henderson and Lallana, with Henderson deeper, Lallana deeper than he normally would be as well.
To be honest, that 4-1-4-1 stroke 4-3-3 setup was, he was playing in the position that I originally thought that we were going to play him in when we first signed him.
The number eight?
I thought he was going to be part of that. Where Coutinho was played in the past, I thought that's where he was going to slot in for us, and he'd had some goals that we were lacking that in from that position in 2014. So I thought that's where he was going to sit anyway, and then obviously he's been played higher up the pitch, and I think that's really exposed his lack of pace at times. So I do think that if this is something that Klopp can see in him, if this is something that Klopp is willing to give him a go at, we may well see an improved Lallana in terms of his overall contribution. I agree with what Pete said there about he was one of our better players last season, but his weakness is always the numbers, isn't it? It's always the assists and the goals. And I think out wide, when he's played in that position, it's not necessarily played to his strengths. If he's playing a little bit deeper with, as you say, runners ahead of him, maybe he can have more of an impact on proceedings.
I noticed, actually, there was a moment in that half where Lallana received the ball just inside their half, just past the centre spot. And he did that thing Lallana does, where he gets it in and in one movement he's shifted his feet and he's got it onto the other foot. And he was ready to make the pass. Now, in that position, that looks sensational. Mm. Too often when I felt, when he's out wide, he's using it as a way of checking back so his pace isn't, lack of pace isn't exposed. It seemed a more natural position for him. Out wide, I can't, he does my head in because he knows if he's got a yard on his fullback, he can't take him. He just doesn't have the pace to do it. So he does that little drag back, doesn't he?
He does
that drag back and looks in field.
Yeah, he's never going to beat a man, is he, going down the line? He's not a winger, is he? You know, he's never, and the fullback knows that as well. So it's pretty easy to mark him in that position because he's always going to come inside.
He's got brilliant feet.
He's a superb footballer, he'd
fit perfectly into an Arsenal team, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he's a superb footballer. I like what you said. I think if he plays a bit deeper, I've got no issue with him anyway, really. But then everyone doesn't score enough, and I think I'll just shut up then. But playing a bit deeper, I think he could be spot on. And the likes of the pace of Mane, that'll make everyone play better, but I think you'll notice it, like you say, more with Lallana, because all of a sudden he might have 6 or 7 assists in like 20 games, you know, and then you're thinking, okay, that's starting to add up that. But I rate Lallana. I think he's a good player.
If he does play in that number 8 position of a 3, I think there's a couple of key things that are key for him. One's positive and one he needs to work on. To play in that position, you've got to have the work rate. We saw Jordan Henderson play in that position in 13-14 and make it his own because of his work rate. You can never criticise Lallana for his work rate. And although he's not absolutely rapid, he's quick enough to play in that position and to get up and down. So that's not a problem. But where I worry about Lallana there is just his ability to release the ball quicker. We all say he's got great feet. He can get away from players, but he does have a tendency, I think, to hold onto the ball too long. And I felt that he slowed us down at times. Now, that might be more of the case, as you were saying then, because he's been on the wing. And he's covering himself, and
it could be runners as well.
For me, that's what I'd like to see from him. I'd like to see him concentrate on releasing the ball earlier in that position.
Remember when we played Palace away and Lambert scored, and Lallana put that pass right to the middle, didn't he, with his left peg from like the centre circle? That's what I think he could offer now this season. I think that if Lambert was hardly a runner, but you know what I mean? Mm. He made the run, Lallana seen it, found him. I'm hoping that playing a bit deeper, looking up, he finds that space as well, like, you know, brilliantly.
I think he was hanging onto the ball too long and like doing his pirouettes that infuriates a lot of the crowd, you know. It's because there wasn't that movement in front of him.
Exactly, that's what I think.
There wasn't that movement last season due to injuries and various other things. But I think if you see that movement, he wants to release the ball quickly. You can tell that because he's a one-touch player, really.
He's always looking up as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the one. I like sort of like a poor man's Beardsley in a way. He wants to go quickly. Not even knowing near Beardsley's quality, but what did you make of Wijnaldum, who was sort of arguably his partner in that central three? Henderson deeper and Wijnaldum and Lallana ahead of him. Quiet, but there was interesting things.
It's hard to really judge him on that one performance. I mean, the interesting thing is that I didn't know a few of the Newcastle fans who do their fanzines. You know.
Yeah.
And they were texting me when we bought and going, we owe you a pint, can we come to Liverpool and buy you a pint? You
know, they're quite sticking the boots in.
Yeah, because they were saying he's brilliant at home, but he won't play away. You know, he's just, you know, now, you know, that's obviously their judgments on it. But I think maybe he's thinking, he's at Newcastle, I'm thinking, we're going down here, you know. It's a different, you know, Liverpool might suit him. With a bit of ambition. And a few more signings, he's trying to impress. That might suit him.
That away thing, it comes from, I mean, whether they're being fair, I don't know, because when you drill into that, he scores 11 at home and none away.
I think
it's a quite clear conclusion that people are drawing there up there. But if you look at his history before that year at Newcastle, in Holland and all his other clubs, that's not been the case.
No.
So he's not...
And Newcastle themselves were better at home than away.
That's it. How were they setting up away from home tactically?
It's one of them, isn't it? They're hardly an attacking team, are they, going away from home, Newcastle?
They're probably the worst away side in the division.
Exactly. Yeah. So he's probably had about three shots away from home.
So it's probably an unfair, criticism, really, isn't it? But, you know, it was interesting to...
It's good to see him finally, like, play though, you know, the other night.
Yeah.
Good to see him just at least run on with the kit on and that and think, there he is.
How are we actually saying his name?
I think I've read it's Wijnaldum.
Wijnaldum.
I'm saying Win, but it's Wijn. Wijnaldum.
I'm going for Genie.
G-Man.
Yeah.
Right. Well, one of the interesting facets of his performance, and I think we expected to see this at times, and Klopp talks about this in the interview he does with the Anfield Rap, which I'll keep banging on about, and we're going to talk about in depth later in the show. Klopp talks at length about the desire of getting bodies in the box. He says, no successful team has good moments by getting bodies in the box at key moments. Wijnaldum is a lad who wants to get in the box and augment the attack.
Yeah, he is. I think that's very much is the primary part of his game. He sees himself as a player who arrives late into the box and makes a lot of late runs. Much in the very different player to Lampard, but much in the same way. I mean, I think he would aim to recreate Lampard's kind of numbers, I think, and if we got that kind of number, that kind of return from him, we'd all be very, very happy, wouldn't we? It just remains to be seen that where he fits in. Is he physically robust enough, and does he contribute enough to play in a central midfield position? Or does he need to make his runs from out wide? Is he going to be a player that, you know, by and large, the way he was used at Newcastle was out wide, wasn't it? Making his runs across the box, and maybe that's something that he'll end up doing for Liverpool. I don't think it's very clear yet how we can use him. I know there's been talk about how he's even played as a holding midfielder on a few occasions for Holland and back in Holland.
But that central midfielder, are we really?
We haven't.
You know, if you really look at it, we haven't got that central midfield.
Everyone's talking about the gap we've still got at left back, but I also feel that the gap in central midfield, that general that we want, there's still a gaping hole there.
That we won't get.
I'll play devil's advocate on that. Whereas I'd be, happy to hear we brought in a midfield general any minute of the day, I do think Klopp is looking at Emre Can. He's looking at Grujic even, and Jordan Henderson to an extent. We saw Jordan Henderson at the pivot of the midfield there. He's looking to those three lads, say pick two or one from those three, and going, one of you is going to emerge as my controller this season.
I love Henderson as well. I feel like he's just being wrote off big time, unfairly as well.
Good, didn't he?
And the other night as well, I texted your mate saying, see who's got the armband there tonight. You know, like, who's this stranger that everyone's forgot about? You know, I feel like it's mad, you know, that everyone's just dismissing Jordan Henderson, to be honest.
It does feel a bit nuts, doesn't it?
I mean, do you think Emre Can can do that? Central midfield job, yeah?
I do. I mean, I'm a big fan, and, in the, I get so many shouts wrong, so when I get one right, I'm going to go on about it. But I thought Emre Can would look to play from the minute he walked through the door. And people at the beginning of last season, people were going, no way him in midfield. Certainly not at the base.
But he didn't
midfield.
Have a position, did he? That was the thing, isn't he? Where does he play?
But by the end of the season, people were crying out for him back in that position. Yeah. When he came back against, was it Villarreal? He looked so composed. But you know what? He's a young player. He could go backwards before he goes forwards again. So I think...
Would you have him over Henderson if you could only play one of them sitting?
If you could only play one at the moment, I'd play Emre Can. Yeah, but I don't think it'd come to that. I think if he's going to play a two in a 4-2-3-1, those are his first two picks.
Yeah, sorry, I was just more thinking if he went with the 4-3-3 and he had like one to two other centimetres.
See, I agree with Rob there, you know, because I think Can's... If you were playing the one sitter, then I think Can is his natural attributes suit the position more than Jordan Henderson's do.
I feel like that's a Rain Henderson, wouldn't you, if you're going to play him there, because he automatically wants to go.
But I'd play Jordan Head.
Disciplined enough to do that job. I don't know if he is,
I think that's a question in relation to his age, his maturity as well, isn't it? And I think he's still learning the role. Because he has been pushed around in different positions, us, but look, in the German national team, he's been playing fullback.
I know. Yeah. I would go Henderson myself, if I had to.
Well, like I've been holding off on this one, Pete, but there was one performance I think that eclipsed a lot, and that was a Divock Origi's cameo in the second half. I mean, you know what? We were all very encouraged by him the second half of last season. In the final, we get a half-fit Origi. He doesn't really feature in the Euros. I think in the back of my mind, maybe one or two others, you think, is he going to truly push on, or are we going to go backwards to go forwards? But he looked a little bit special there, didn't he?
Yeah, he looked very impressive. And, you know, I think... You know, last season before his injury, he was impressive, wasn't he? He certainly brings, you know, Liverpool were a different team with Rigi in the team last year. Different team, and we could play the style I think Klopp wanted to try and play. But the other night, he looked very impressive. And, I think, for me, he's got to be starting for Liverpool. He looks that good.
You think if there's only one striker, he gets the nod ahead of Sturridge?
Well, I'd say the way Klopp wants to play. I mean, Sturridge is obviously a far superior player in terms of technique. I think the way Klopp wants to play, I think Origi's going to be in there.
Yes, Stu. I mean, the pace and power Origi gives. I don't know. He looks like he's gone. He looked to me, if you can read too much into 40 or 35 minutes, what it is in pre-season, as though he's ready to go up another level. That was almost Sturridge-like, actually, that goal, wasn't it?
Yeah, he looks he could be a monster. You know, you're looking at him and you can't help but thinking of what he could become. If he can put that kind of performance together on a regular basis, he's going to be a real handful in the Premier League next year. I saw Paul Senior quoting up there. I think the odds for Origi to be top scorer 66-1 might be worth a punt. But I think there's a really difficult decision potentially ahead in terms of who gets the nod in most games between Origi and Sturridge, because I don't see them playing together very often. I can't see that happening too often in the way Klopp has set up this thus far, and also at Dortmund, he generally has preferred one main striker, and his pace and power, these are words that we used to describe Sturridge a couple of years ago. When he first signed for us, his pace was breathtaking, and he had that power. And injuries have no doubt taken their toll. I'm not basing this on his performances so far in pre-season, the one or two performances, because he's just finding his fitness at the moment, and he's going to need a few weeks to get there. But I think it's going to be quite critical for Sturridge to be able to show us all that he can make that 10 yard sprint that he seemed reluctant to do full blast over the last 18 months. When he has come back from injury, he's always seemed to have held back a little bit. He's not been quite the player, almost reminiscent of when you saw Torres after an injury, or Owen after an injury, and it took some time, and they were never quite the same. They never had quite the same burst. Whereas you look at Origi, and he's like a horse on the pitch, isn't he? He's just away. He's just unfettered by any kind of he's uninhibited by any kind of worries, any concerns over his fitness. He seems at one with his fitness, with his body, I've seen Jordan Ibe in pre-season have great games. I've seen Lazar Markovic a year or two ago, I've got eight games in pre-season, so I don't want to get ahead of myself here. But if he can put together that kind of performance on a regular basis, it's going to be hard to take the shirt off him.
Yeah, I mean, Dan, Stu says, I think probably correctly, the Klopp favours a one-striker system. There were hints that he was... that he'd look at Origi and Sturridge together last season. I think that first half at Southampton, they were really fantastic together. I think Sturridge gets a couple, and or he at least gets one, and him and Origi dovetail very well. I can, do you know, there's a theory I'll put you. Brendan Rodgers, I think, set out with the same aim as Klopp, to be a one-striker man. And then Suarez and Sturridge's form changed him.
Exactly.
And I can see Sturridge as a player who takes competition. It makes him angry. You get the impression when Suarez scored, it used to make him angry. I can see. I think it pissed him off. And I can see Origi pissing him off similarly. So that, and if things work out for us, that competition could force Klopp's hand, and be really good for us.
Yeah, I mean, the thing Origi has over him as well is, like, Origi for me does things that, like, fans just like as well. You know, like, he runs into corners, he chases people down. Basic things that you'd want. But fans are into it. I mean, everyone was chanting his name last season, Origi, after like three games.
Headless chicken runs.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Well, yeah, you know, but people like it, don't they? You know, he's chasing down, closing down, and it's like, you know, Sturridge doesn't do that. But I mean, it's that'll always go against Sturridge. Sturridge for me is one of them players who looks like he's not doing much, but he is, and everyone knows how good he is. But I'd try to find a way to get them both in, and that's why I'd go back to my personal formation would be the same one in the season we nearly won it, and I'd have the three of them front, and I'd have Origi playing and Sturridge playing like we had Suarez and
with
Sturridge
Mane.
Playing
I think that'd be
and Mane, yeah, that's what I mean. But it's going to be different for each week as well, though, because we had the conversation yesterday with the lads that, like, I think that, like, Arsenal away first game of the season will be Firmino up front, and neither of them two will play, and he'll
because
play
because of fitness, because he's had most
but just because
season.
I just think Arsenal away, I just think it's going to suit the way he'll want to set up, maybe with, you know, the way Firmino plays, like Chelsea away and City away last season, and he might bring Origi on for the last half hour and not use Sturridge that game. But it's the good thing with the options we've got now. You're not just looking going, well, so it's like when we sign Mane, well, that means he's not playing, for example. But it's not going to work like that. I think there'll be just games of the season when they'll both play, one of them will play, one of them will play, and you just hope that none of them spit the dummy out, basically, and you could have something like really good, you know.
I think it's obvious watching Sturridge and watching him playing for England as well. He is playing. He's not sprinting at all. And I think that's because in the last 4 or 5 years his hamstring's been going all the time. So that's in the back of his mind. Anyone's ever done a hamstring, no, you're not gonna go at 100%. You're not gonna do it again.
No.
It happened to Michael Owen as well, and, you know, to a certain extent Torres, as you were saying. But I think you can see Sturridge, and I think Sturridge has had to change his game a little bit because of it.
Yeah.
You know, when he's a lot cooler on the ball, Sturridge, you know, and he's not looking for that burst of pace, is he? He's looking for that, like, bending into the top corner.
Well, that goal he scored in the final, I think, a year or two ago, he decided to beat that man. He would decide to knock it past that man. But he's just looked and thought, no. You know, and then the goal for England against Wales.
He tried a shot like that the other night as well, didn't he?
Well, technically, he's an incredible player, Sturridge.
Yeah, class,
I mean, the prospect of finding a way to play the two of them together, I mean, that could be a dream. You know, it really could be a dream if you get them on the pitch together. But as you say, I think it's going to be horses for courses. I think there's
going
to be...
You could play Ings as well. You could play literally the three of them. You could literally have Ings, Origi, Sturridge, and just say, right, the three, you're just going mad a bit.
I don't want to see Sturridge chasing mad balls.
I don't,
you know,
that's what I mean.
It's ridiculous,
yeah.
But fans are like that, aren't they?
Yeah,
you think, oh, you know, what's he doing?
But, it annoys me, like, but
you know,
that's just the way it is, isn't it?
He's got to play, with a football brain.
Well, look at his goals. There's two last season he scores for me, which show that where he may even have something even on the likes of Owen and Torres, who both after they lost their speed, they just couldn't. They couldn't be effective in the same way. But Sturridge last season still has this almost goal every one and a half game ratio.
Yeah.
But he scores two goals, which for me are quintessentially a sort of goal pee. The one in the derby where he finds the pocket of space. He's suddenly there behind their defence. He hasn't had to use pace to do it. Just know-how, and he's popped one in. And he scores almost the identical goal against Villarreal, I think, in that second leg.
Yeah.
That's to me is a striker who's way bigger than a pace issue.
Yeah. And when he scores those type of goals, he seems to have so much time on the ball, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's close.
And even looking at the Euros when he's playing for England there, he seems to have a lot of time on the ball. And you can just imagine the pace of those games, especially against Wales. And people translate that to being lazy.
I just don't understand it. It's mental.
You know, it's ridiculous.
It's absolutely mental. It kills me, honestly.
Yeah.
It really does.
Just the last thing the AC Milan game, there's a lot of issues we could keep talk about all night here, but Stu, just focusing on the defence for a minute, to one side of it, actually, the left-hand side, what did you make of Clavan at the left of the two centre-backs and James Milner again in the left-back position?
Clavan looks great, I think, so far. I mean, it's very early to be talking him up, but, you know, we want to see what he looks like in the competitive matches, but so far he looks very solid, he looks very confident, and he's bringing the ball out without being a Beckenbauer-esque player. He looks comfortable, looks confident in his own ability to do that and to pass into midfield. He's obviously got a tackle on him, we saw that the other night, and you know, there's early signs that there might be a little bit of a partnership there starting off with Lovren. All that said, though, you know, Milan really were poor in the game against us, so it would be we need to see what he's like when he's tested, but so far very, very pleasantly surprised on how he's turned out. Milner, so I like James Milner. I'd always keep James Milner in the squad because he's just your odd job man, isn't he? He can do any job anywhere and put a 100% in. But if you're asking me whether I'm happy with him being our second choice left back now, I'm really not. And I can't imagine that he is either. I can't imagine that, you know, he's had lengthy discussions where he's come out the room thinking, yeah, brilliant, I know my job for this season, I'm happy with that. I can see real sense in him being second choice right back. I can see that when we're needing to get maybe a little bit of extra quality in terms of delivery from wide areas. But when he's playing on the left, although he can, and he showed that in the cup final against City, he can deliver from the left hand side. He does have to check back, and I'd be much happier if we went and signed a tried and trusted left back there to challenge Moreno.
Oh, Dan, I'm at the moment, if we were starting tomorrow, I'd have him at left back. I think he gives you a degree of competence, intelligence and defensive solidity. But although he has to check inside, he still has a hell of a delivery for out wide once you do get him into forward positions, which he does better in open play than dead ball.
Yeah, I'd have no like real issue with him playing left back, but I just don't want him to play left back because he's not a left back.
Where else do you get him in the team? And is it important to get him in the team?
I don't think it's important to get him in the team as such. You know, I don't really know where I'd play Milner. Probably as one of the attacking midfielders if I had to choose somewhere to play him, but he wouldn't be in my starting 11. I don't know. I wouldn't have him left back, no. I just wouldn't. I want us to sign a left back as ideally the opposite to Moreno, somebody who's just out and out defensive, and then you can just alternate the both of them. I think if Moreno got injured, Carrier style, and I looked at me at James Milner left back for the next 10 weeks, I'd be gutted with that. Like,
yeah, he'd obviously do a job, wouldn't he? But you know,
I don't think he'd be happy about it
balance.
As well. Like,
it doesn't
Stu
give
said,
you the
sorry.
Balance if you've got, like, you know, Milner left back, that doesn't give you
he's
the
not a left back, is he? And no, he doesn't want to play there. That's another main issue for me. Is he come to us wanting to play centre mid? No, okay, he might get a game centre mid as such, but I don't think he's come. I don't think he wants to play left back, and he's thinking about swerving England as well, which means he's obviously wants to concentrate solely on the club. I don't think he's going to want to be setting back up left back.
I'm not sure it's fair to him, to be honest, because although I trust him completely to go and do a solid job there.
Yeah.
I've just got this fear of, I've just got these visions of whether it's opening day or in the first few weeks, if he's playing left back, him being a fault for a goal, and us all turning around going, well, what do you expect? He's James Milner, he's playing left back.
Exactly, he's not a left back, is he?
And you can just imagine his head going, you know, knowing that he's at fault and he shouldn't be there in the first place.
You know, when Carre played left back and when John Flanagan played left back, they were solid, weren't they? They were solid players, but it didn't give the team that balance.
Exactly.
Because, you know, Carre was always turning into onto his right, same with John Flanagan.
Well, even like Carragher was good right back, but you wouldn't want him right back, would you?
No.
Do you know what I mean? He could play there, but you wouldn't want Carragher right back every game. He was well better centre half.
Yeah.
I just think play your players in their where their best position is. You know.
Yeah. I'm happy enough with inside out fullbacks. I remember Rob Jones doing all right at left back for a good while, even though he was, I suppose he was exceptional at right back. But I put my personal view is I'm quite comfortable with him there, unless we sign an exceptional left back from somewhere. I'm quite happy with him there. I like that. I don't think he gets in the team anywhere else readily. If any of these lads deliver anywhere near the level they should, I don't think he gets in the team. And but not that we have to get him in the team. But
you know, Rob, you know, if you'd had Klein and Milner at right and left back, though, I'd switch them over.
Well, that's
I'd have Klein at left back and Milner at right back.
Not averse to that. Yeah. Not averse to that. All right, I'm going to...
Why was that?
Well, I've seen Klein play left back well. You know, quite
more
a lot.
Two-footed.
Yeah, I'm not even sure about that, but he's a natural fullback, so he knows the job. And I think that you're asking James Milner to do two things: you're asking him to play on his weak foot, and you're asking him to play in a position that is relatively new to him. Mm. Whereas if you play him at right back, you're asking him to play in a position that's fairly new to him. He's played there far more than he has played left back, but he's also on his stronger foot. Klein, if you put him across to the other side, he knows what he's doing. He's a fullback, you mentioned Rob Jones there. You know, he was playing on the opposite side, but he knew what he was doing as a fullback. You've never got a positional issue, have you? So for me, if that was the issue, I'd be going, all right, we'll keep Milner at right back, throw Klein over.
You're setting yourself up for excuses, though, as well, by doing that, because the minute a goal goes in on Klein's side, it's like you've just said the game about Milner.
Right.
Everyone's going to be like, well, he's not a right back. You know,
sign a left back.
Exactly, just sign a left back and it's done, isn't it?
I'm surprised that Moreno's still there. After, you know, after
Clavin can play left back.
I think he is. I think he is. Yeah. I think he just looked at Joe Gomez getting another injury. Thank God for that job. I thought he'd seen him off last season. But okay, let's just move this on. Our boys, Neil, John Gibbo, and Andy are out in the west coast of America, due back on a plane tomorrow, and they've been bumping into celebrities left, right, and centre. Got a great little piece which is available on Tour Player with Steven Gerrard last week, and they repeated the trick and then some by bumping into Jurgen Klopp, and have done a great interview which is available on the subscription service Tour Player. It's about half an hour long. It's a really, really good interview. It's really worth getting to hear if you can. I know some of the boys here have had a listen to it. I thought Dan they got quite a different kind of Klopp out of their interview. He seemed to have a more, what's the word? He seemed more emotional. I thought it was a credit to the lads.
Yeah, it is, yeah. It's sort of what, like, you know, you'd expect when somebody's just bumped into someone in like a cafe or something like that, and they just literally sat down and had a conversation. But it's a brilliant interview, like, and he comes across well, like you'd expect, but better really than, I'm not trying to just like get everyone to listen to it, but better than like a press conference or something, because it was as if he was just comfortable answering the questions, you know. And yeah, let his guard down a little bit. Great, great interview, yeah.
Stu, what was interesting was when they talked to him, they talked to him at length about what he liked about football, what he looked for in players. He seemed to focus quite a lot on footballers get into the game because they're human beings who ostensibly like playing football for the purity of kicking a ball about. They don't get into it for money. And that sort of early motive they have, that's what he felt he was looking for in a player. That came across, didn't it?
Yeah, it really did, yeah. He's an idealist, isn't he? I mean, you only have to listen to the interview for it to really become apparent what his football politics are, and to show why he's such a great fit for Liverpool, because he is a football socialist. It was, if you change the accent, the content of what he was saying could have been Shankly. It could have been Rafa. You know, the talk... It could have been Kenny. The talk constantly about not individuals, but about this team ethic, and actually us all being part of the team, the whole community, not just the players on the pitch, but the crowd. They're important to me. And that really came across how much he values the input of the crowd. I forgot even what you'd asked me now, Rob. I'm just
about what he looked for. What he looked for in a player, and the fact that he looked for that innocence, I think, still in footballers.
That desire, that enjoyment, he spoke about that a lot. Let's enjoy this. We're only here once. We're only here for a short period of time. Let's do everything we can to enjoy it. I feel like I'm lifting quotes directly from him now. Mm. You still need to listen to it and subscribe. but he's very much looking for players who are selfless and who will get on board with the direction that he's going, with the vision of a collective purpose, and who will get on board with the idea of this is a game to be enjoyed. Let's make the most of the opportunities that we've got.
Yeah, Peter, Andy in the interview asks him a question about about just where he sees the fans in the scheme of things. And it was, I suppose, you know, when it's an earnestly asked question, but it, I suppose, it invites a platitude about the fans are important, blah, blah, yeah. blah. But he went further than that, and I think you've probably heard a range of interviews where I think he's hinted that, not just it's the 12th man or yeah. whatever. You know, he reiterated this point that if you play a football match with nobody there, it is not the yeah. same experience yeah, yeah. as in a full stadium. Yeah. And he felt the Liverpool crowd was almost unique.
Yeah, I've been a bit disappointed with Klopp and his relationship with the fans, to tell you the truth. I mean, I know he's done things like bringing the players towards the Kop. Hmm. You know, after a draw and things like that, you know, but we were led to believe that, you know, he socialised with German fans and took them to Christmas parties and went to the local supporters club and got all the players to pull pints for the
yeah.
fans.
Yeah.
He hasn't done anything like that. Now, I don't know whether that's the hierarchy who've warned him against that. But apart from the fact that he was photographed in a couple of, in the blind school, wasn't he, mm-hmm. in Harbin Street on the first couple of nights.
Yeah.
And in the quarter restaurants. Apart from that, he hasn't really engaged with the fans. And I think it's all right saying in interviews, yeah, unique in that, but I don't think he's actually done that much. You know, that might be controversial to say that.
That's a good point.
He certainly hasn't ingratiated himself with a lot of fan groups that exist. You know, and I'm surprised by that. And I think the reason for that is possibly that the hierarchy have told him, don't be getting involved.
But it was 6 or 7 years in when he did that at home, and you know, yeah. with the pulling pint. It was when he were having a bad, very bad season. He were right at the bottom of the league, and it was his way of saying sorry. But I think I do see what you're saying, Pete. But but he's only been here a few months, hasn't he?
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe you know, he's just got other priorities at the moment.
No,
you know,
I'm sure he has, and I'm not saying, you know, he should start going into pubs and start pubbing. You know, because which pub would you choose? I mean, everyone's saying, oh, we should have chosen that. But I mean, I think, you know, the idea, I thought, you know, for example, even having an open meeting where supporters could go to and, you know, open question, I thought that type of thing would be going on. Mm. You know, because obviously since Rafa, you know, and since we haven't had that type of communication, have we? And I think there's certainly a lot of people have said to me, you know, oh, it's all, he's playing lip service, to, you know.
That. Still gets me going, though, even if he, I don't think yeah. he is playing lip service, but even if he is, it still gets me, like, now I literally just want to go and start screaming at the match.
I felt you know, in his early months, he's been almost a bit self-conscious that he doesn't want to be a cliche of himself.
Yeah.
That he's holding back a bit. You know, like, it was almost from day one, but I think a lot of people expected him his first match to go up to the Kop with fists outstretched.
Yeah,
go,
definitely.
Come
yeah,
on,
yeah,
let's yeah. out, let's be having you, Delia style. Yeah. And I think he almost felt like, I think he almost said, like, I'm a bit more dignified than that. Yeah, I'm not just some big mouth who'll come
in. Well, for him when a goal goes in, though, that's enough for me.
Yeah, the childlike glee. That's enough for me.
Just a bit disappointed, but you know, when the walkout happened,
yes,
77 minutes, you know, he never made a statement. But oh, you know, obviously, he's being diplomatic, isn't he? But you know, we could, you know, for me, you know, it's been a bit of a disappointment on that aspect of things, you know, not on the aspect of celebrating goals and knowing what to do communally for the television. I'm talking about the grassroots stuff.
I think we judge him on that one in 2 or 3 years' time.
Yeah,
is my opinion.
Yeah,
I
mean,
like,
you know,
that's you said, yeah,
I'm not condemning him. I'm just saying.
No, I know.
I thought there'd be more. Now he's been here for a section of a season and now a full season. He might start, you know, doing that. But there's loads of opportunities to get involved with grassroots stuff, which wouldn't have to be in front of the telly cameras. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? You know, say for example, he did something with the Brilliant Initiative, the food banks, which, you know, which have been going on around the ground. A simple gesture like that, which wouldn't have to be for the media. Media wouldn't have to be present, but that would spread like wildfire.
Yeah,
do you know,
yeah.
that's the type of thing I'm saying. That's why I think he might have been warned off that type of thing.
The danger he's got is I think he's damned if he does and he doesn't. You know, it could be seen as however much he could try to downplay it, it looked like he was being self-serving. I get the impression that he feels he's got to earn the right
to be able to
walk into a pub, to play the man of the people.
Yeah.
Rafa
saying he's waiting to win something.
Yeah, maybe, you know.
Maybe.
Because I think playing the demi, you know, that's the problem. People want him to play the demigods, but there's a part of the man you sense who goes, oh, God, I'm a bit embarrassed about this. I'm embarrassed about the adulation here.
Well, we all loved him before he'd even
come,
hadn't he?
Yeah,
you know, and it's If and he's always somewhere where Mike Nevin is as well, he might not want to go there again, Mike. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it was fascinating in the interview, Stu. He's talking, the boys asked him what his favourite moments were, and he said, I think Gibbo said, you know, Villarreal, your team seemed to play as exactly as you wanted to, and the other suggested other thing, but he just wasn't having it. It was Dortmund for him, and he just said, you know, in the moment, that's the most important, most incredible experience I've had in my football career. What happened in that 25, 30 minutes?
And he put that very clearly down to the crowd's involvement.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, he spoke about, you know, it getting back to him from some of the Dortmund players. That they just couldn't believe in that last 20, 30 minutes what was going on. They were asking themselves, what is this? What's going on? And it was that cranking up of the atmosphere that is different from what happens in Germany, where it's that constant flow of noise, that constant beat that's throughout the game, although Dortmund are a little bit different to that. But he'd never seen anything like that. And it was interesting how he was saying that he still didn't think we were going to get a fourth. He still didn't think we were going to do it. But for it to happen, and for it to happen in that, I mean, he said that was the greatest moment he'd ever had in football, didn't he? I think he said I've had some great times, but that's the greatest match of that I can remember. Now, as I say, he wasn't slow to put that down to share the praise around with the crowd's involvement in that game, and he was very clear in saying, "Well, why can't we do it more often?"
It's a good point. I think the one thing he's been surprised about is the lack of atmosphere at Anfield.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially in the league games. Yeah. Now that game was exceptional.
Yeah.
You know, European night. But you can see he's been thinking, I've been told this magnificent cup, and like, it's just, you know.
Because it works both ways, isn't it? Because like I say, before he come in, you know, everyone expects things from him. We all love him and all that. But it happens when players come in, like he's come over to us expecting this. And then when it hasn't happened, like both ways, he could be sitting at home with his missus going, God, I thought he was a bit more lively than they are. Because you do hear these things, don't you? You know, and then they come over and it's not like
was
that.
It was against Villa where people walked out pretty early. Was it Villa or?
Oh, something like Southampton at home when it was 1-1.
And like there was a mass exodus. I had not to do with ticket prices. Yeah. Just a mass exodus, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And he got angry, you could see he got angry. Because that doesn't happen in Germany.
Well, he said that in the interview, he said, didn't he? You know, it's just like he says things when he had a little moan, didn't he, about he felt alone. He said, like, I'm not like making things up. It's just like what I feel at the time. And sometimes it gets him into trouble saying things, but it's just he speaks how he speaks.
But I love that. I
love him. Club.
Absolutely. The way that he'll, it's not everyone's cup of tea, this, but the way he'll turn around and bollock the main stand.
Yeah.
You know, that gets me right up, that does, you know what I mean? That gets me going, because he's right. He's right. We are paying customers, we want to be entertained, but actually that's not what we go for. That's not, if we're talking about players putting money aside, well, let's do the same as fans. I know it's hard, but let's put that, that's not why we go to the game. Otherwise, we don't go because it's cheap. We don't go because of money. It's not a factor in why we go. It might be a factor in why we don't go, but it's not a factor in why we go. We go because we want to be a part of something. We want to be entertained, but we want to feel a part of it. And too often, as you say, you know, a Sunday afternoon game against Fulham or Newcastle or whoever, you know, Bournemouth, the crowd do find it difficult to get up for it. And we've been spoiled by so many big European nights, etc. But we need to do our job there. I mean, he's very clear
about
that.
Definitely, I agree. Even the friendlies there, sorry, Rob. Even the friendlies, like the Sammy game, like when that goal went in, and like that kid lashed a flare on the pitch, I know it sounds mental. But I was like, I'm into this here. Because even though it's just a friendly and it's like, that's what I want to go with the game. I want it to be mad every time you go. And like, you know, I'm not going to stand
did
up
you
in
go on the pitch at the end?
No, I didn't, you know, but I've seen you did, yeah. I was thinking I'll get nicked.
I think he's probably surprised at the setup in the Premier League, isn't he?
Yeah.
The fact that in Germany it's this communal atmosphere, you've got 51% of ownership and that, and when you come to Anfield, it's totally different. And I think that's what surprised them, I think. So I think, you know, certainly I think, you know, in this season, we might see more, you know, communal type stuff, you know.
People seem to do what he says as well, don't they? I feel like now that it's built, now he's thought with the fans, I'm hoping now that most games when you go to them, it will just be, this is just what we do now.
Yeah.
No matter who it is at home.
Was Sacco mentioned?
No, he wasn't. No, he kept stumbling.
That's the only thing we want to know about.
Actually, if you unsubscribe, he reveals exactly what the situation is. Like, carte blanche on it. No, actually, look, we've skimmed the surface of what's in that interview. It is a really, really good interview. Yeah. What came out of it at the end, which I loved particularly, was there's a real steely determination that we're going to do something this season, that he feels he's got his own team, that we will be in the shake-up in all competitions, so help him God. That was the sense that came out of it. I do urge you to try and listen to it. It's a fantastic piece of work by the boys. I've really enjoyed stealing Neil's show off him this week. Thank you very much to Dan for joining me, to Stu for joining me, for Peter for joining me. You will have Neil back next week. You're totally safe. Lots of great other shows coming out this week. Thank you very much for listening.